Thanks very much once again for being part of this LGS teaching event, where every time I come, I learn a lot from the students who ask questions and the juniors who ask questions. And incidentally, I happened to listen to the senior most person who has done a lot of work on corrosive strictures. And today I learned quite a lot. And before, is Kanchan still on the line with us? The last question which she asked, Professor Ananda Krishna, I can...
Yes, sir, I'm still on the line, sir.
Radha, can I just take
it? Yeah. No, this time is yours, sir. Your choice.
Okay. Kanchan, what answer did you actually expect from sir?
Sir, actually, I wanted to ask about the retrograde dilatation, whether it is indicate, what are the actual indications? He told it is not, it is for long strictures.
Yeah, I was listening to him. There are few people who do it. And in government, Stanley Medical College, they do it regularly and they have published also. The other question which you asked him was about a short segment stricture at the lower end.
Yes, sir. Yes.
What was the answer you expected from him?
Sir, actually, we discussed it in telemedicine a few weeks back.
And I know that. That's why I'm asking you. Otherwise, I wouldn't have brought it up.
We came to the consensus that we have to do a short segment. The first conduit of choice will be jejunum for this case, and we will do an intrathoracic or a transhiatal. We will do an anastomosis there. So, and we have been taught that whatever esophageal stricture, we have to do a cervical anastomosis. So that was a doubt.
The way you asked itself, I understood that you wanted him to tell this answer. But if you asked, if you have asked me also, I wouldn't have done a small bowel jejunal interposition for a lowest segment, short segment stricture of the esophagus. If you have the fear that malignancy may develop, if it is undilatable, if you have to remove the esophagus, lower end esophagus is not difficult to remove. The rest of the esophagus, according to you, is normal. You can do a pull-up, do a cervical anastomosis. No problem at all. But the interposition for a short segment, corrosive esophageal stricture, maybe... I don't think I will do for that. That is the answer I wanted to give you, though I was listening to sir.
Okay, sir.
Kanchan, are you with us?
Yes, sir. I'm there, sir. I got
well,
it,
I don't
sir.
Think my answer convinced you, but that is the one. See, short segment interposition, I will show you now about the interposition. We are going to talk about the conduit. And today, Professor Radhakrishnan has asked me to talk about the most devastating problem, discussion topic, which no surgeon would like to see or to talk, is about necrosis of the esophageal conduit, the salvage strategy in the postoperative period. This is one thing no surgeon would like to see or experience in their career. Anytime, whatever conduit they use after esophagectomy or without esophagectomy for a gastric pull-up. So this is most devastating, but three things you understand. Majority of the situations, it is either underreported or unreported, and you cannot have RCTs for this. And if you go through the literature, majority of them will be series or case reports of conduit necrosis, and you may not come across RCTs to look for conduit necrosis. And I have to acknowledge a few of the images which I'm going to use are given by my friends who have encountered complications, and I'm acknowledging that. But most of the complication images which I'm showing today are the complications which we caused for our patients. And over now 35 years, we have learned how to overcome their complications to a reasonable extent. So I will assure you, I will talk very little so that we can discuss more, and even one person can ask 10 questions also, provided there is time. So the complications have been standardized because of the esophageal complications consensus group in 2015. They have standardized, but we don't know how much it can be practically used, especially in centers which has different facilities, managing different volumes and different expertise. So two things you should know. One is the type, the other one is the grade. Now, there are three types, so two slides, which is in the textbook I have shown, type 1, 2, and 3, depending upon the extent. Focal necrosis, again, type 2 also focal necrosis. This is identified only endoscopically and the second one is with a leak. The third type is necrosis, which is extensive. No need to do only endoscopy, it will be evident. And the other one is the grading from 1 to 4. These 2 points are already there in your textbooks. In fact, these are taken from the textbooks depending upon how severe the ischemia or necrosis is. It can be either after doing an esophagectomy for malignancy or esophagectomy in rare situations of corrosive stricture or after a bypass for corrosive stricture where the esophagus, as Professor Anandakrishnan said, is left behind. So my focus today will be necrosis, which has taken place in the neck, because the strategies are totally different when it is necrosis which happens in the chest. That we can discuss another day, because neck versus chest itself is a totally different topic by itself. What are the types of conduit which you usually or commonly use? An youngster would always like to use as the stomach, only one anastomosis. Colon has multiple anastomoses, as we discussed in the previous discussion, because long segment, and jejunum usually used for interposition in the neck for failed conduit necrosis. Stomach is preferred because it is extensive vascularity and it is in fact difficult for you to produce necrosis. This used to be the stomach in the 90s, which used to take the whole stomach. But now with the tubularization technique, it can easily reach up to the pharynx. That is not a problem at all. Colon, as was pointed out earlier, has named pedicles, and the pedicle which you sacrifice and the pedicle which you preserve depends upon which segment of colon you want to use. So it has got named pedicles, namely right, middle colic and left colic. So the length which is available to us to take it as high as possible is extremely good. But you remember, when there is a tubular structure which you are taking through abdomen, chest and to the neck up to the pharynx, there are a few things which you should remember. There should neither be tension in the bowel nor be tension in the artery or vein. You should never pull it, there should not be traction. And when you take it through the chest wall, there should neither be a torsion or twist. All these can be the culprits for ischemia or conduit necrosis. This is more common with colon than with stomach. So these are all the named pedicles which you have, and the pink colon after, you can see one point which was mentioned is to apply a bulldog clamp, and after you ligate all the vessels, you try to keep the colon over the chest wall to find out whether it reaches comfortably to the pharynx without tension to the colon, without tension to the artery and vein, and the tip should remain pink and pulsatile. That is ideal colon. Then comes jejunum, which is less commonly used, may require microvascular assistance, as was discussed. Sometimes it can be very tricky, both in terms of getting the length and in terms of avoiding the curvature. You have to cut the mesentery without jeopardizing the vessel if you want to take a straight jejunum. Another advantage is sometimes you can even use one more segment of jejunum. The first segment which you are trying to take is ischemic. This is how it becomes. If you want to take a long length, it may not be straight, in which case you may have to give a mesenteric cut without producing a compromise to the vascular supply. Compression factors are the one we should remember when you are taking it through the retrosternum. This is not applicable when you take it through the posterior mediastinum. After esophagectomy, the compression chances are less. Whereas when you take it through the retrosternum, there can be compression either at the hiatus here or at the thoracic inlet here. And now itself I finished telling one important point, and that is the reason why we have started cutting this upper end, thoracic inlet, to make it wide. I don't know whether you were able to participate when I showed my technique of doing a colon reconstruction. So for the LGS participants today, I will share a mix of evidence and experience. We can discuss a lot, the lessons we learned and the innovations we have done. Only one reference I'm going to show, which was published last March, condyle necrosis following esophagectomy. Actually, there is no need to show even this because Ananda Krishna Shah has clearly showed the incidence of necrosis can go even up to 50% in some studies. The ischemia, it is in the gastric, can go up to 10.4. And in it is colon up to 13%, which was in the study shown up to 50%, and in jejunum up to 11.3%. So this is the data which was published March 2019, and this was the one which was presented in ISD, and we have also published our own study 2 years back on how to manage this ischemia. So most important issue is to differentiate between ischemia and necrosis. The point we should remember is all ischemia do not convert into total necrosis of the condyle. If we are very lucky, it can only go in for stenosis or a trivial leak or a leak in the neck, which can only manifest as a dilatable stricture. And once it becomes necrosis, it can again be only tip necrosis, or the next thing I tell is suprasternal necrosis or upper partial necrosis, and the devastating one will be a total colon necrosis or total gastric necrosis. This distinction is crucial as the treatment is different, because if there is only ischemia, endoscopically evident, clinically no leak or a trivial leak, or the conduit in the neck is fine, I will show you some images. You need not to bother much. If the ischemia or necrosis goes into the chest below the level of the suprasternal notch, then you have to be really concerned about what exactly your treatment philosophy is now. The major decision making will be on whether you are going to leave the conduit there or remove the conduit or part of the conduit, what you are going to do with the rest of the conduit, whether to retain, or if it is stomach, you are going to remove it fully, having colon as the second option in mind. I will show the images of all these conduit necrosis which we have produced in 90s. You have a color like this, it's very favorable. That's why everybody is very happy. But this is one of the images which we did in 90, we can make out. We have brought the colon here, and because the color was not all right, we did not do the anastomosis. So that's what sir was telling, if it is not pink and pulsatile, you can either abandon the procedure or don't do the anastomosis. Wait, this is what one of the patients, I even remember his name, and he lived in our ward for 4 years with that so-called cervical colostomy, only to commit a suicide at the end of 4 years. He didn't want even it to be reconstructed. You can make out this colon may look nice if you see through the colostomy bag, but we were concerned because our experience at that time was not much to take a chance, because every time we started doing a coloplasty, we'll start at 9 in the morning, it will go up to 6 in the evening. Next day when you come and open the neck, it may look dusty. We'll wait for one more day, and there are so many situations where we removed the colon. You can see few of the images. But when it comes to the neck, when it looks dusky, the surgeon is always concerned whether to do an anastomosis or not. You can make out this mucosa and this mucosa, and there are options now. This particular surgeon, he has already desired to do the anastomosis. He has opened both. And once you do an anastomosis, there is every chance it can leak. If you have not brought it under tension, there is no need that it has to go for necrosis, especially if it is stomach. So once you do that, even if you have done a proper anastomosis or a doubtful anastomosis, to find out ischemia or necrosis, before you go into the investigations which you have, proper clinical examination will definitely give a clue on to whether there is a necrosis or not. These are the few things you cannot miss. In a patient who has undergone a colon pull-up or a gastric pull-up, these two things are very, very, very important, systemic. Temperature and tachycardia, the surgeon will always think something is going wrong with the conduit. He will not even think it can be a pulmonary complication, but he will think only something is going wrong with the conduit. And locally, you can see there can be edema, erythema, and if it leaks, there can be discharge. Open out the neck wound, there can be a discoloration. This is one point I want to stress. If you have an NG tube, which you will invariably have, if you have a dark color aspirate in the NG tube, that means your conduit is not fine. And if you allow it to go like that, it is not uncommon to see the patients desaturating. This is not acute. You can make out we already even removed the sutures, but still the rice tube is there. When you have a swelling like this, there is a possibility it is only a contained leak there, not necessarily a necrosis. This is not my slate because I don't use a transverse incision. Once again, a contained possible leak. Majority of them may settle. What we used to do was, when you make an incision like this, when there is a swelling, we lay open all the sutures. You can make out that is a site of anastomosis. It can usually be a small trivial leak, invariably settles on its own, but it can produce a stricture and in most of the situations dilatable. But when you have something like this, this color is not looking very good at all. Here is the doubt which you will have whether you have to remove the conduit or there is no need to remove the conduit, wait and watch. So a pulse rate like this is totally unfavorable for you. And chest x-ray may show you that it has tracked down into the chest from the neck. Now there are three things. The most feared one many people have is whether we can do an endoscopy in the post-operative period. It has been accepted by everybody. Doing an endoscopy, which is a careful endoscopy, will definitely tell you about the status of the conduit. And that is why the first two slides, table one and table two, I put. Second thing is the contrast and CT scan involving neck, chest, and also going into the abdomen, which can give you so much of information about the conduit, the extent of collection, and even the necrosis and how far it is in the neck, chest, or even it is going to the abdomen or not. Contrast, when you give, it will tell you about the leak. I will show pictures for each. ICD is still there, the contrast is coming out. It is coming from the neck into the chest. If you are really unfortunate, it can be this much also in a pull-up, after the pull-up, and the collection in the chest can be on both sides in the CT. Two images, wherever I put a mark like this, that is not my image. You can visualize the conduit, the bluish discoloration. When it is a pink mucosa, you will be very happy. When it is like that, you will be definitely unhappy. So endoscopy definitely plays a role. If it is only in this place, the rest of the conduit, when you pass the endoscope beyond that is good, you can still hold. You need not remove the entire conduit. Passing distally, sometimes the endoscopy can tell how much of leak is there, how the rest of the conduit looks. Once you recognize the conduit, the necrosis is there, what next you have to do? There are so many factors which you should have in mind. What is the conduit which you have used? When you have detected, if you have detected on table, on table, if you have done, if you are detecting the next day, or it was fine for a week, after that there is a leak, everything matters. The grade and type of the damage, performance status of the patient, the expertise we have in your center, and the facilities which are available in the center. So everything matters in managing a condyle necrosis. This point has already been brought out by Professor Anandakrishnan. Request your anesthetist not to use any drug to maintain the pressure. So what are the strategies? I am not going to follow what I discussed earlier, the type and grade. If it is minor and suprasternal, the treatment can essentially be conservative. Patient is unlikely to be in sepsis if it is only in the neck. Once again, I'm showing those three pictures again, only to tell the patient will be definitely very comfortable if it is trivial and suprasternal. If at all, it can go like this, and that can easily be dilated either with a subregular dilator, or you can use any of these dilators because it is going to be only in the neck. This is what he was mentioning, using a Foley's catheter, subregular catheter. In fact, there are few things the urologists and gynecologists use. That also you can use to dilate the cervical stricture. This is what Sir was mentioning about Professor Chatterjee, what he will use to do. The patient herself or himself can pass it beyond the level of that, inflate, initially taught either by one of our colleagues or by another patient, and you can make out, they bring it out with the balloon, that they can practice in their own place, because most of these people come from villages, they cannot visit to a center regularly. That is about the trivial leak which has settled as a stricture which you dilate first, then tell them to do self-dilatation, but they should come and report to you the minute they feel they are not able to eat properly. Sometimes you may have to re-enter the neck to do a strictureplasty. He was once again mentioning doing the site-side anastomosis will give you the opportunity to extend the anastomosis. If there is a stenosis, you can either do it with the Hanson anastomosis. And I have even done a paper anastomosis. There is something like a septum. When you do a side-to-side anastomosis, even a stapler can be passed from the neck with the guidance from the intraoral guidance. You can staple and do an anastomosis to widen a stenosed anastomosis. I want you to carefully monitor all the next few pictures. You can make out this is the immediate post-operative period. When you have a swelling, I told ecchymosis or induration or swelling, this is the stomach. This once again, this series is not my patient. That is the stomach. You can obviously make out there is a dusky stomach. The lower end has been opened out. The full length has been opened out. It looks fine here, but here it is dusky. You see the serial images, looks dusky, but still the entire stomach has not gone in for necrosis. So now when the surgeon waited, he can make out this place has gone in for total necrosis, but still this stomach looks okay. In endoscopically, if this area of the stomach looks okay, there is a possibility you may be able to use the same stomach to reconstruct, or the segment which is available or necessary for reconstruction is less. This is the next picture doing the upper end necrosis. And I can also show you, you can see the NG tube. That is the stomach which is removed. This stomach looks normal. The idea why he has done this is to find out whether he will be able to use the rest of the stomach which looks apparently normal to do a re-anastomosis. But if you had the fear that this color is dark, you would have removed the entire stomach, which we can sometimes avoid. Patient can go like this and they can settle with a trivial leak without a need for a second substitute. Next comes transmural necrosis, tip only. These are the points which I told. Conservative re-anastomosis if it is a short segment using the same conduit. Stent is the one which is not desirable to keep in the neck. Stents are used for anastomotic leaks which happen in the chest. It is very difficult to keep it in the neck for the patient. So stent may not be a very good option when there is a cervical leak. Here you can make out there is no other choice. The colon, you can see it has gone in for necrosis. Necessarily you have to remove. And then you consider, you mark the upper end and come for future reconstruction. Let me not go into the stent, which has already been discussed. Now we'll come to the partial necrosis. Not only tip necrosis, partial necrosis. Partial necrosis, I mean necrosis from the pharynx, which goes usually up to the level of the sternum. Invariably, the compression at the thoracic inlet only produces partial necrosis. What is the role of taking down? Do a cervical esophagostomy and then do reconstruction. The question to be answered is, how long you have to wait before you consider a reconstruction? And what is the substitute which you have used and what is available to you to use as a second substitute? Taking down is the easiest decision for anybody. But once you take down, I would suggest if the necrosis or the extent or the length of necrosis is less than what you have anticipated, try to preserve as much as possible, which may come in handy for future reconstructions. This is another series. This is our patient. You can make out first day you see, open out these sutures. Don't be scared of the images. The entire colon here looks necrosed. Till you are confident it has not gone into the chest. You see how it is going. That is a necrosed colon. This is a final end. But the point I want to convey here is, everybody who happens to see something like this, I'm 100% confident, including me, I would have pulled out the entire colon. But the patient did not have any systemic findings. So we waited and we were sure that it was only up to the suprasternal area. And this patient, we were able to do a delayed reconstruction. You can make out, it stops here. But the segmental loss will be from here up to this, and that has to be reconstructed. Patient gives you sufficient time to think and act. Let me not go into the so-called myocutaneous flaps for short segment strictures, which once again has been discussed earlier by sir. Let it be pectoralis major or sternomastoid, which we don't do anymore. But now you have very good evaluation modalities. Once the patient settles, you will find out what is the length of necrosis which has happened. This picture you can see, this entire colon looks normal, absolutely normal. But this is the only, there is the upper end which is normal. This is a colon which is normal. Only 3 centimeters of necrosis has happened. So you have sufficient options to reconstruct this segment. If you are in a hurry to remove the entire colon, you will really find it difficult, because I used to say, when there is a colon, as stomach is gone, colon is there for you. But when colon is gone, I used to call it as end of the road. But now, even for that, we have found out few more options which can be used as reconstructive strategies in these situations. So now the CT can tell you about what is the exact length of necrosis which has happened, whether the upper end is available or not, the lower end is available or not. See, beautiful reconstructions are there. So the options other than the myocutaneous flaps are taking the help of a microvascular surgeon, using an interposition jejunal graft. You can make out one loop is being prepared, artery and vein are separated. Now it is brought to the neck for anastomosis. And here we did not remove the entire colon. We left behind the colon inside the abdomen. But now you are creating a subcutaneous tunnel. We are not going back into the retrosternum because you anticipate dense additions because of the previous sepsis. And this colon which is available has been brought up. This jejunum has already been anastomosed by microvascular technique in the neck. And you complete, this is the colon which is available. You do a colo-jejunal anastomosis here. And the upper end, you do a pharyngo-jejunal anastomosis. That will be the best one if there is no total colon necrosis. This requires the help of a microvascular or a plastic surgeon. And we have innovated another technique, which I have named it as advancement coloplasty, which has already been presented and it has already been published as abstract publication in ISDE as well as in SSAT. That is advancing the available colon, which I have taken it even up to a level of 7 centimeter. This was the first case which I did in 2003 actually. This is a video which I'm not playing here. You can make out the redundancy of the colon. Once again, I just want to tell you two things. Number one, if you have seen the image shown by Professor Anandakrishnan, the neck anastomosis was side to side. When he showed the colo-gastric anastomosis, the colon was taking the shape of a reverse J. And those are the one, the colo-gastric anastomosis is absolutely fine, but there is so much of redundancy. And the vessel which goes, invariably where they have taken the left colon to the neck, this redundancy is very common. And this can be used to take it further to the level of the pharynx after doing a sternotomy. And the first case which I did was in 2003. And you can see he's still under follow-up. That is the sternotomy which we have done. You'll be wondering how I'm going to take so much of colon can come, and this is what is the length of viable colon you will be able to take, and this can reach any level for you to do an anastomosis, and this is possible. You should have sufficient length not only of the colon but also the pedicle should not be under tension. Because I am moving the colon upwards or advancing the colon, I have named it as advancement coloplasty. But the precaution I take is, say I make a wide inlet here. The compression is usually here. I make a wide inlet. This is the photograph which has been taken from the head end of the patient and kept here. When we did the first case, now we have done 13 of these cases. When we did the first case, we didn't have the confidence to do an anastomosis. So I left the colon in the neck and completed the anastomosis after 6 weeks. And now we do it once. He is the gentleman who is still alive, lives in Tirupur. And this again, you can make out how we do a sternotomy. And that is the colo-gastric anastomosis, the colon which is advanced, and you do a revision pharyngocolic anastomosis. The scar may look gory. So from the suprapubic area up to the angle of the mandible will be the scar. But you can make out that is the immediate postoperative picture. And you can make out the patient while she came on follow-up. This is there available where we have presented our initial experience in 2013 and 2015 and 2018. So now we have 13 patients. When it comes to total necrosis, you have no other choice than to take down the colon and you do a cervical esophagostomy. Find out the patient definitely has a good enteral access and still have the hope there will be delayed reconstruction. When it is stomach like this, you can remove it. Colon is always available for you. Once again, I want you to find out from here up to this place, the stomach is gone. If it is only here, we wouldn't have removed the stomach also. And you can see how the stomach can also be devascularized like this. So the colon can be used if stomach has gone into necrosis. The desirable time is at least for 3 months. Don't be in a hurry to go for reconstruction, but see to that the patient has feeding jejunostomy and monitor the patient regularly so that they don't become malnourished, because you are going to subject the patient for another major surgical procedure. I buy time. I don't even operate within 3 months. I push it in 6 months waiting period. As long as the patient is maintaining the weight, I wait for the next reconstruction, because that surgical procedure is also not going to be an easy one. But when colon has already been used, the options are limited. This is how the entire colon has gone in for necrosis. You have no other choice than to remove. In fact, you can make out this is 1995, we have removed the entire colon. And unfortunately, you can see the age of the patient also. Age is only 25. Esophagostomy, if esophagus is available, once again, the point was stressed. Anything available below the cricopharynx is good for the surgeon. So if total colon necrosis, what options you have? I have one experience with each. Using the left behind esophagus. If I have used the right colon, second time I use the left colon. This patient, in fact, has also gone to one of my colleagues in Madurai. She was 53 years, I operated on her. She was fine for 7 years. Seventh year, she drank acid again. So that colon went in for necrosis. We tried using the rest, other colon, opposite colon, but still we succeeded, but we lost the patient. There is only one experience with using long segment supercharged jejunal graft. That was done by one of the microvascular surgeons. So we have experience of using the left behind colon in one patient and long segment supercharged jejunal graft in one patient. We have not more than that. So the salvage strategy has to be individualized, and pre-op and intra-op evaluations help, and that is beyond the scope of this lecture. And if there is time, any number of questions I'm willing to take. Yeah, Radha, over to you. And
yes sir, thanks for questions. And Kislai, to start with.
Good evening sir. I need only a clarification sir. If there is upper partial ischemia, the patient's vital is stable, so you said we can wait and observe the patient. So that's, is it the same way which I have understood sir?
Yes Kisle, you only presented the case last time, right?
Yes sir.
You made a wonderful presentation. There are two important points you should understand. The first and foremost is you should be absolutely certain that the necrosis is not going beyond the level of the neck. The externally you can see by opening out the entire neck wound. Internally you can see by doing an endoscopy. If you are certain that it is stopping only in the neck, definitely you can wait. If the patient also has septic features, systemic symptoms, as I showed, the temperature and tachycardia, chest collections and all, then you will not have the courage to wait. You have no other choice than to take down the condyle. Only when you take down the condyle, you will know it is only a upper necrosis. Now, you don't sacrifice the entire condyle. Try to keep it. You can either keep it in the abdomen, you can fix it to the abdominal wall somewhere, so that later on, when you want to reconstruct, the residual portion can be useful for you in the reconstructive strategy. You understood it right. If you want to go back to that slide, I can show you, because it may look very bad when I showed those picture, how he had the guts to wait when the finding was like that. But that's the same patient which, this is what you asked, Kisle, you are right?
Yes, sir.
Kisle, are you with me?
This is what yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Here, this will definitely rebound immediately. But if the endoscopy you are doing, from here it is absolutely normal. Yeah, you ask. Yeah.
Yes, sir, I got it. I'm listening, sir.
Anyone else want to ask questions?
Am I audible, sir?
Yeah,
Kisle. Yes, sir, I am listening, sir.
I'm able to.
Kanchan, you seem to have a question in the chat box. You come out in the open with your question, Kanchan.
Yes, sir. I wanted to ask that the picture you showed was a reverse J, in the reverse J manner of cholecystic anastomosis. Does that mean that it was sutured to the posterior wall of the stomach?
The image which I showed?
No, the image which sir showed.
The image which I showed, you can make it. This is to the anterior wall of the stomach.
During explaining the redundancy of the image, sir, colonic so conduit. Yeah, the image which Anand Krishnan sir showed, and then you were explaining something regarding colonic redundancy. You related to that same image which sir had shown, and it was in the reverse J manner you told. Was it sutured to the posterior wall of the stomach?
In that image, I did not notice whether it is to the posterior wall or anterior wall. But I can tell you, just see my arrow. It was like this. This is redundancy. Understand? That redundancy is more common with people who use left colon than right colon, and people who use the end of the colon for a cholecystic anastomosis. I use a side-to-side anastomosis. When I say, for example, even in this image, I have done an anastomosis of this part of the colon to the stomach, this redundancy wouldn't have come.
Okay, sir.
And that is easy if you are using the right colon.
All right, sir. Thank you, sir.
Sir, in the chat box, Dr. P. Surendran wanted to know whether you use ICG for assessment of vasculature.
No, Radha, I don't use ICG. I don't have. But there are so many papers where they use ICG to assess the vascularity of the tip of the conduit before they do the anastomosis. I don't have personal experience in that.
Yeah. Surendran, yeah, you can come up with what.
Yeah. Good evening, sir. This is Surendran.
Yes, sir.
Sir, when do you do endoscopy after this, sir? Do you routinely do a protocol? Do you have when do you to do an endoscopy after this coloplasty?
You are talking about acute injury or after coloplasty?
After coloplasty.
After coloplasty, if everything is fine, there is no need to do an endoscopy at all. Only when you suspect that something has gone wrong. Let it be a minor ischemia or a leak, or you're suspecting conduit necrosis, then only there is a need to do an endoscopy. Second point is, majority of us, even I had a major fear, if I do an endoscopy, I can make a small rent into a big one. In reality, if you do a careful endoscopy, that does not happen. At the same time, that gives you so much of information which will help you make a decision on whether to continue conservative therapy or to do any intervention. You can definitely do it. A careful endoscopy is permitted now, as long as you are doing it.
Yeah, Dr. Pramod, your question?
Sir, when you re-explore for these cases, do we find any pathology like torsion or tension, like we take precautions, or usually there is no torsion or any pathology?
Now, when you are re-exploring for a total necrosis, that and all will not be seen. You saw the stomach, which I showed, no, how it was looking. At that time, it is very difficult for you to say. You would only see a necrosis conduit and totally thrombose artery and vein. At that time, it is very difficult for you to find out, because your hand will go inside and bring the conduit out. The conduit invariably will be friable and come out almost like pieces if you have not intervened early. that is not the correct time to find out whether you have produced a twist or torsion.
Ravichandran Palaniappan, you have a question? Okay. Yes? Sir, there's a question in the chat box from Srishant KS.
Yeah.
Sir, if there is no common trunk of middle colic artery, can we make take colonic conduit based on left colic artery?
So, there are two things I can understand from this question. He was not there for my presentation, the video lecture on the coloplasty, how I do it. The way I do it is I try to preserve both left colic and middle colic, number one. Number two, the middle colic usually does not read the textbook. The textbook will say the middle colic coming as one trunk and separating into right and left. In reality, if you see, middle colic may come straight and turn right and left, or it can be two like this, or it can be three, or bifurcate after 1 centimeter from the origin. That and all we have to decide intraoperatively, and that is where sometimes when they are doing a CECT, with CT cologram, they can also request them to do a CT angio of the abdomen, which will preoperatively tell you what is the status of the main pedicles. Having said that, one of my postgraduate is doing a study in the postmodern study on what is the vasculature like for colon, which are to be considered for coloplasty, to find out whether it is still the same ileocolic, right colic, mid colic, and left colic, where it, how long is it, where it separates in the right and left, up and down.
Sir, one question from Dr. Bhavik. How do you manage open neck wound?
How do I manage?
Open neck wound.
Open, that is the easiest way to manage. All that you have to do is give enough pads to the patient. The problem is when it is open neck, the saliva keeps on coming. That is the one which disturbs the patient. And that is the reason they will not allow you, they will request you, they will beg you to reconstruct at the earliest possible time. Otherwise, managing a neck wound involves only usage of multiple pads, unlike abdominal wounds, which has GI content. Here it is only saliva, nothing else. But that is really disturbing to the patient. They won't even come out.
Any more questions from the audience here?
So again, Surendran, sir.
Yes,
sir. So is there any experience of using these grafts? Because I've seen people using aortic vascular grafts as a conduit temporarily and then reverting back to reconstruction later.
No, sir. I have not used one so far in my life.
Praveen?
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, actually, I remember once you were telling, whenever we place a graft retrosternally, you don't anastomose directly. You do the first colocolic anastomosis, then again reassess the graft, and then do the anastomosis. That, I think, is a very good, valid point, which you had told in one of the talks, sir.
Now, even now, I reiterate that point. There are so many ways, because before, while opening, you are seeing the vascular pedicles. And after that, you decide on which vascular pedicles you are going to ligate. For those pedicles, you are applying a bulldog clamp. You are leaving everything inside the abdomen. You are going into the neck to find out the place for anastomosis. When you come back to the abdomen, it is definitely 20 to 30 minutes. In 20 to 30 minutes, after the bulldog clamp being applied, if the colon looks normal, definitely you can ligate all those vessels and transect all those vessels. Now, in spite of taking all these precautions, the sequence of anastomosis has to be from the abdomen. That is the better one. You have understood it right. And I want to reiterate the same point. You do a lower anastomosis, and that gives you still some more time to find out whether the colon continues to remain pink in the neck. You understand? First you do a neck anastomosis, then after that you see it is dark. Now we don't know whether you'll be able to continue or take the colon further to do a reverse anastomosis. The sequence will be like that. Now that our team is experienced, what we do is, once we are very comfortable with the vascularity, one team will do abdominal anastomosis and one team will do cervical anastomosis. But if you are the only surgeon, this may be a preferable way of doing the sequence anastomosis.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
On that note, I think I'll close the session, sir. Thank you, CM sir, for such a wonderful lecture, very patiently explained and very easily understood. And thanks everyone, and hope we'll see you sometime soon, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Radha, for the opportunity. Thanks once again.